Okay, so we've been talking about the compaction, which is in the chapter 5 in the textbook. Before we start talking about the field compaction, let's define the terminology. Barrel fit. So when we do the field compaction, we need to have a soil to compact, right? And we can use the soil in that place, or you can borrow the soil from some other place. And when we borrow the soil from other place, we call it barrel pit. The place that we borrow the soil is called the barrel pit. Okay? And then there will be a excavator or remover, pokrane. Pokrane is a wrong name because it's a name of the company. Pokrane, instead of pokrane, 굴삭기라고 많이 쓰죠. Or the earth remover. You can say that. And you remove the soil and you dump the soil on the truck, right? And then that dump truck will transport the soil to the construction site. And then they will spill or the spread all the soils on the site. Then you will have a bulldozer and a compactor to compact the soil, right? So excavator, remove the soil from barrel pit and dump the soil and spread and compact. That's the procedure, general procedure for field compaction. Barrel pit, as I said, the area where the material has been dug for another location. And usually field compaction is done this way. So you spread the material using the scrapers or some bulldozer over a layer, and then compact with a roller. So I should buy this the roller figure, but say that you have a roller and you spread the already there some material, and this roller will go back and forth. Huh? Right? So you can control the number of passes and the weight of roller. So you can buy very heavy roller or you can borrow the very light roller, right? And that's kind of you have a different cost for the different rollers. And also you can roll the area very fast with a higher speed or low speed, right? So there's a pros and cons. So if you go do it very slowly, it's gonna compact more efficiently, but still it's gonna increase the duration of the project, right? So that will increase the labor cost so that the overall the budget is going up. So to control the roady, so in the compaction, we always look at the dry density or void ratio, right? And from the dry density, we can calculate the relative density. And roady and the the water content for each layer. So energy into soil is defined by weight of roller and number of passes and lift thickness. Lift thickness is a thickness of each layer to be compacted. So once the one layer is completed, then you dump another soil and have compact another layer on the top of it, so another lift. So we can compare with the standard proto test, actually. Standard proto test, we control what? We control the weight of hammer. That's gonna be the weight of roller, right? And number of drops, right? Number of drops will be what? Number of passes. And the speed of roller is going to be also the number of drops or the energy, number of height or something like that. And lift thickness will be corresponding to what, the layer, because in the standard process, how many layers you have? Three layers, right? So that layer will be like the same with this lift thickness here. Then you measure the total density and water content, so that way you calculate the dry density. Right? So field compaction, let's go over the field compaction equipment. I think if you have previewed the lecture material, there's more explanations and you can read it through. And also in the textbook, there are more explanations. Smooth wheel roller is the just common type. Pneumatic roller, you have a rubber tire, so that's why they call it pneumatic roller. And shoot foot roller means that you have some protrusions in the roller so that they have some kneading effect. It's like kneading effect. Kneading effect, 밭 갈 때 밭 가는 거랑 똑같은 현상이에요. 밭 가는 거, leading. So that you have a protrusion here on the roller, and as you roll it, it's gonna make some leading on the clay, the clay surface or the soil surface. Tamping foot roller is the same, but you have a tamper, so it's similar to the sheep foot, but the size is different. And tamping foot roller, when we look at the tamping foot roller, you have a protrusion like this, and this is very good and efficient for fine grain soil. Coarse grain soil, you don't need this kind of effect. Coarse grain soil, you just need a plain, very smooth wheel roller with some vibration. And fine grain soil, you need to have this kind of a kneading effect to increase the dry density. And vibrating drum on the smooth wheel roller means that you have a smooth wheel roller, and then they put this motor to give the vibration on this roller. And so as you go back and forth, you can also apply the vibration energy to the soil. Dynamic compaction is very interesting. And this one. So this is the video clip showing the dynamic
crawler
compactor.
Crawler cranes are often used for allows continuous drops with a maximum precision. All relevant air HS850 25-ton winches. Time greased rollers ensure access.
Yeah.
Specially designed components.
So it's the same project. I think that they were building some island or a beach shore. And this is for the dynamic compaction. They just drop a very heavy weight on the top of the soil.
The first phase, with an area of 1.1 million square meters, was finished within 6 months. The six Liebherr HS855s achieved a total number of 950,000 drops within this time.
So it's like, I have no idea what this country is, but so they build some kind of a park and the tourist attraction, maybe like Dubai with some island, and then to make the island there, dump the soil and compacted that soil for constructing some park and the buildings on the top of it. So the speed was like this number. So in an hour, they drop it 80 times, 81.3 times, and daily drop per crane is 1,000, and total drops per month is like this much, 187,000. Good. So the dynamic compaction can achieve the densification to depths of about 10 meters, up to 30 ton, and 30 to 40 meter drop height. But the limitation is you can only make a 50% surface coverage. Yeah? So equipment summary, impact, it's like standard proctor test, you apply the impact to the soil, right? You're dropping the hammer. And kneading is good for fine grain soil, vibration, good for coarse grain soil, static is not very efficient. Static is always normally for the asphalt kind of material. These are the application example, like rock, steady weight, kneading, vibration, steady weight. Oh, where is it? So as you go this, you have more clay. Here you have 100% sand. And you can see that as you have more clay material, then you have a tamping foot. You start using tamping foot more. Then, how can we decide the equipment type? There are several characteristics for the compactor, like mass. You can determine the weight of the drum and the size of the drum, so wider will be better, and operating frequency and the frequency range for the vibration. Is heavier always better? One question. And the characteristic of the soil is very important to determine the this equipment type, right? The initial density, grain size distribution and grain shape, and the water content. Grain size distribution means that you know the how many fine fractions you have in the soil. Right? And the construction procedure, number of passes of the roller, lift thickness and frequency, and the towing speed. So towing speed is like slowly moving it, then duration will be longer, so that it's gonna increase the cost. Lift thickness, thinner will be always better, right? Because then you can compact the whole layer with the homogeneous compaction. But as you get thicker, maybe the bottom is not well compacted, maybe the top you have more compaction, so that will cause some difference in the layer, dry density difference in that layer. One example, so people use this kind of a chart to determine the vibration frequency. For example, so y-axis is the dry density and x-axis is the vibration frequency. So you can see that you have a different symbol for the different roller weight. For example, let's look at heavy clay one. Heavy clay one is the round hollow one. Circle, so 7,500 pound roller weight is, and you can see that this kind of a heavy clay vibration frequency is the cycle per minute. 2,000 cycle per minute is the optimum frequency for this equipment, right? So you can refer to this kind of a chart to determine the operating frequency of your machine. What else? Here, gravelly sand. This is how weight. The weight is 7,502, and the gravel, sand, clay mixture. It's about how much is it? 2,400 cycle per minute. Vibration frequency will be like central, and the optimum frequency for that. Right? So each equipment have different optimal frequency, and depending on the soil, that you have different optimal frequency. So you just be aware of the existence of this kind of a chart, so you can refer to. Roller travel speed and roller passes. So this graph shows that roller coverage means that how many times you go back and forth in that area, it tells you. And this is the dry density. So for example, I'm compacting this lift and using this roller, if I go 1, 2, 3, and the number of passes is 3. So number of passes 3 will be like here, somewhere here, right? So you have a dry density increase from the initial point by this much. And as you go more, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, now it's at 12, now it starts to converge. So it's not very efficient as you increase the number of passes from this moment, right? Then you're just wasting your money, right? Wasting your dollar. So this is more obvious here. Oh, sorry. This is a clay soil. Like when the number of passes is more than 8, you don't need to do it more, right? So 8 will be like maximum number of passes you can apply for the that project, right? Given number of passes, a higher density is obtained if vibration is towed more slowly. Oh, so, and also we can look at the towing speed. Towing speed here is 3/4 mile per hour, 1.5 mile per hour, 2.25 mile per hour. So you can see that as we slow the towing speed, the dry density increases, right? For the same number of passes. So slowly, you're towing it, then you get more, you get higher dry density. Here's the another example for roller passes. Two roller passes, you have a density distribution over the layer. So here you can see the depth is about 3 feet. 3 feet is how much is it? 3 feet. 1 feet is 30 centimeter. So 3 feet is about 1 meter, right? So this is about 1 meter, 1.5 meter thickness of the lift. And you have a maximum density here, and as you go deeper, it just decreases, right? And when we look at the dry density here, so it's not the SI unit, it's a pound per cubic feet. It's about 102, 103, and 5 roller passes, it increases over 105, and 15 roller passes, it's a little over 105, so but it has not increased that much, right? And 45 roller passes, still is the same, right? So this tells you that maybe like 5 or so coverage, there is not a great increase in density. So maybe like 5 or 7, that will be the optimal number for the number of passes, right? For your project. Just an example. But it's not always true. So you may have a different number for the optimum value, for the different site. Determine the rift height. This is interesting because you have a relative density difference from the shallow area to the deeper area, right? In general, you have some amount of a compaction effect up to like 2 feet, so it's about 60 centimeter or 70 centimeter, and from that point, you have a decrease in dry density. So then the landowner or the project operator can require for you to achieve like 70% of relative density. So they force you, it's on the contract, it says in the contract. So your relative density should be higher than 70%. Okay? Then you can draw the line from 70% from to here. And then then that corresponding depth is about 3 feet, right? So from here to here, okay. From here to here will be the thickness that you can use, right? So then from another layer, you have some same thickness, and another layer, you have the same thickness. Okay? So that will be the lift thickness, proper lift thickness that satisfies the 70% relative density. So here, so it says this one. So then this curve, 70% is about 18 inch. So 18 inches, how much is it? How thick is it in centimeter? 18 inch. 18 times 2.5 centimeter. 얼마 정도지? 18 times 2.5. 4 inch가 10 centimeter인가? 4 inch is 10 centimeter. 45.7이? 45cm, 45cm. Okay? So 45cm is the optimum, the lift height. Next is about the design construction procedure. I think I can just skip it very fastly. Laboratory tests are conducted on the sample and the proposed borrow material to define the property required for design, and then field compaction control tests are specified. The result of these become the standard for the controlling the project. So I think I already mentioned it in the first class. So you have the barrel pin material, right? And you take that to the lab and you do the standard proto test. You get the compaction curve. And from that, you determine the optimum water content and the maximum dry density, right? And using that information, you're gonna refer to the table in the I showed you before, like equipment capacity or the vibration frequency. And then you define the compaction control test. Okay? So there are two ways for the project. One is method specification, and the other is the end product specification. Method specification is the owner responsible project. So owner gives you all the specification, like what type of a roller should be used, how many passes you should go over, and how many, like what would be the towing speed to be used, those kind of, all the bottle material too. So here, owner gives you all the specification and you just follow that specification. And the, whether that dry density is satisfy the specification or not, doesn't matter, because you just did what you are told to do. Here, it's typically used for the large compaction project. And end project specification is different. So, owner or the project, the government, or the Hyundai Consul didn't care about what type of roller you use, how many speed, like how many lift thickness, they don't care. They just want to have the result meeting the specification, meeting the, satisfy the requirement. Okay? So they will just say that you have to require, you have to meet the 90% relative density. Okay? For that material. Then you do whatever you want, and the end project, they always check the only the end project. Maybe the relative density and the water content. Okay? 그래서 내가 이제 오너면 방법이 두 가지가 있는 거지. 아, 나는 신경 쓰기 귀찮으니까 그냥 여기서 난 잘 모르겠고 뭘 하든 간에 이 요만큼의 땅을 컴팩션을 하는데 그냥 90%로 상대 밀도 맞추고 워터 컨텐트는 10%만 해주세요. 10% 플러스 마이너스 1% 이렇게만 해주세요 하는 거지. 대신 프로젝트 기간은 3달입니다. 이렇게 얘기해가지고 3달 후에 가서 찍어보는 거야. 테스트 해보는 거지. 진짜로 맞췄나. 그게 end project specification. 다른 거는 뭐냐면 예를 들면 method specification is for larger project and very sophisticated project. For example, nuclear power plant. 막 내가 지금 한국수력원자력발전소 공사 사장이야. 이 사람이 아 이거 지으려고 그러는데 우리 방식대로 지었으면 좋겠어. 얘네는 왠지 잘 모를 것 같아. 그러니까 이 컴팩션 하는 컴퍼니가 이렇게 좀 예민한 구조물에 대한 작업을 별로 안 해본 것 같아. 그러면은 얘네를 좀 믿기가 좀 그렇잖아. 그러니까 너희는 대신 싸게 하는 대신에 내가 하라는 대로만 해 하는 거지. 그래서 내가 이 롤러 이용하고 이 방식 이 스피드 뭐 2km로 왔다 갔다 하고 8번은 꼭 해야 됩니다. 8번 이상 하세요. 뭐 8번 왔다 갔다 이상 하세요. 즉 리프트 시퀀스는 10cm 이상으로 하지 마세요. 뭐 이런 식으로 항상 스페시파이를 모든 걸 해놓고 대신 책임은 내가 질 테니까 너희는 하라는 대로만 제대로 했다는 것만 우리한테 알려주세요 이런 거지. So there's two way. 그죠? 다른 건 됐고. So, when you check the, so it's very important to investigate whether the field compaction is well done or not. Or poorly done or well done. How can we check? We have to check the dry density of the field material after the compaction. And also we check the water content. Right? So this is the way for checking the dry density in the field. So they compare the dry density from the field to the dry density that's obtained in the laboratory and use this value for the checking. So relative compaction. Relative compaction is defined as the dry density from the field divided by the maximum dry density from the standard proto test or the modified proto test times 100. Typically, people require the 90% or 95% relative density, relative compaction. And how can we determine the water content then? Let's say that we have a maximum dry density. So let's look at the curve A only here. Curve A is the compaction curve obtained from the lab, standard proto test. And we know the maximum dry density. And the optimum water content too, we know this one. And if the contractor asks you to satisfy 90% of the relative compaction here, then what would be the water content you should use? You should use the water content between X and Y. Otherwise, you cannot achieve this relative compaction or the dry density. Your dry density will be always less than the required value. 그죠? Right? Any question? 혹시 여기 질문 있니? 그래서 이거보다 so if your water content is less than this x and y range, then no matter how many passes you have or how slow you tow the roller or the how heavier equipment you use, you cannot achieve this relative the dry density higher than the 90%. Because that's what it says in the laboratory test. Okay? So you have to satisfy the water content and the dry density together. Okay? Probably the water is too short or the too many, then 맞지? 정화야 맞지? 워터 컨텐츠가 너무 많으면 실험이 힘들죠? Yeah? I think you have experienced it all yesterday. And also specific compaction equipment. So sometimes so these days, people develop a very good compaction equipment. So now, with the same weight, you get the more efficient for the compaction. So then, sometimes you get the different, you have to use the different compactive effort. So this is the standard prototest result, modified prototest result. If your roller compactive effort is in between, then you get different, you use the different compactive effort, then you get a different compaction curve and use that for the reference for field. Okay. So this gives you an idea about the compaction curve depending on the soil. Here, the first graph has the largest dry density, 제일 크죠? And the lowest water content. That is well-graded sand with some silt, a little bit silt. How many fine fraction? Fine fraction is
동구. 동구.
Fine fraction 얼마니? How many fine fraction it has in the soil number one? 응. This is the percent. 몇 퍼센트 있어? Fine fraction. You can sum up 12%, right? So that's why you have a SW and SM, right? Yosef, here, the fine fraction is in between 5% and the 13%. So you have to look at the gradation and Etterberg limit together, right? So it says that it's well-graded soil, sand, and also it has some silt. What about the second one? Second one is here, it's a little bit less, it has less dry density. And how many fine fraction it has, Joseph?
How much fine grain?
Soil number two. 15? No, it has also clay here. Oh, 28%. 28% is less than 50%, but larger than 13%, so they look at whether it's a clay soil or the silty soil, right? They found that it's a silt. So silt here. And as you go below, here, only 12%, 28%, how much is this one? It's 25% clay. And the lean clay, oh, is 68%. Now it's 95%, 95%. So as you go below, you have more fine fraction. And in the as a result, you get the lower dry density. So void ratio is higher in the fine grain soil, right? That's the typical result that you get. And also you have more water content, right? Higher water content as you have more clay and silt. And poorly graded sand is very interesting. Poorly graded sand is located here, the compaction curve. It's much, much smaller than the well-graded sand. Well-graded sand보다 훨씬 밑에 있죠. Dry density has very small dry density because it's not uniformly graded. It's not well-graded. So it's maybe it's uniformly graded. Huh? So hard to control the dry density, poorly graded. I think we can read it. So test site, when first the test site is selected, it should be representative or typical or the compacted refit and the borrow material. A typical specification call for a field test for every 1,000 cubic meter to 3,000 cubic meter also, when the borrow material changes significantly. It is also advisable to make the field test at least one or maybe two compacted lift below the already compacted ground surface, especially when chip rollers are used or in granular soil. So it tells you that how often we should test in the field after the compaction. So it says that every 1 cubic meter, 1,000 cubic meter, 3,000 cubic meter. So scraper will deliver some amount of soil, and maybe as you, they do it lift by lift, and inspector will come and dig it and measure the total density and the water content every 1,000 cubic meter. And when we inspect the compaction site, we have to get the dry density and the water content, but how can we measure it? How can we measure the dry density and water content? It can be destructive or non-destructive. How can we measure the dry density and the water content? Let's recall what we did for the compaction test. Compaction test, how did we measure the dry density? 어떻게 했지? Yosef, how did we measure the dry density? Take the sample. Measure the mass. We put it in the oven. Then you get only the water content. So, So you have to have a mold that is that you know the volume of it, right? And then you measure the mass inside that soil. That soil can be moist soil. It's not dry soil, right? Because after the compaction, you have to add the soil, right? So, water. So that it's moist soil, you have total mass and total volume that gives you total density, right? And you take the sample and you measure the water content. So now you have a total density and the water content. Then you can calculate the dry density by using which equation? Equation 기억하는 사람이? Is there anyone remembering the equation? Raw total density divided by the 1 plus water content. Then you get the dry density, right? So when you, so it's the same. When you go to the field and you are the inspector, now you have to find whether this satisfies the 90% relative compaction or not. Then you measure the total density and the water content. Water content, measuring water content is very easy. Because you can just dig it and then measure the total mass and then dry it and then measure the dry mass, right? That way you can just measure the, then how can we measure the total density in the field? You can dig it, but as soon as you dig, you're loosening the soil. Volume will expand because it's been compacted by heavy weight. 어떻게 할 수 있을까? 응? How? 어떤 ratio? What ratio? 한꺼풀어서. 본 사람, 비디오 본 사람 없니? 비디오 본 사람 중에 아는 사람 없을까? 응? 구덩이에 부피를 댄다고. So you dig the soil and measure the hole, right? Excavated pit, the volume of the excavated pit. How? And mass? Mass, how can you measure the mass? You just collect all the soil from that hole and measure the mass, right? 그렇게 하는 방식이 가장 쉬운 방식 중에 하나니까. So you can always measure always the surface of the lift right? after the compaction. Then measuring mass is easy. 이제 흘리지만 않으면 unless you spill some soil, right? If you collect all the soil from the excavation, then you can measure the total mass, water content. How can you measure the volume of the excavated area? For example, here, this is compacted area, and they dig a hole by this much, and they want to measure the mass, the volume of this excavated area. Then you can use it as a total volume and divide the mass with that. Then you get the total mass. So difficulty is in measuring the total volume. 그게 어려워. 귀찮고. 없을까 방법? Any idea? Here I give you some example. Here they use the dry sand, and then so it's kind of a graduated cylinder. So it's filled up with dry sand, graduated cylinder, and you stand it upside down and pour the sand and measure the amount of the volume decreased of the dry sand pack. Okay? Yeah. So then you measure, so dry sand is filling up all the irregular surface of the duck pit. And second way is to using the balloon. So we're assuming that the balloon also, because always when you dig it, it's not very flat surface. It's not smooth surface. It's kind of very rough surface. Yeah? So measuring the total volume is very difficult because it's a rough surface. And balloon, we expect that the balloon can smear and make a good contact with this irregular surface. Last method is you put some plastic bag here, plastic bag or vinyl plate here, or some fabric that is waterproof, and then pour the liquid on the top of it, and measure the amount of the liquid has been poured to fill that the deep duck hole. 다른 방법, other method you can think of? You make a mold, like, make a mold. After digging the hole or before you dig the hole? But that's the same with the standard proto test. It can be different from field compaction. I thought you were talking about some plastic dough making a mold. No? Other idea? So measuring the volume of excavated area is difficult. If you have some ideas, just let me know. We can file the patent together. 특허 같이 냅시다. 그래서 돈 봅시다. 할 수 있으면 좋아. 난 그런 거 I was thinking of some kind of pizza dough and measure the volume of the pizza dough, but still it's very difficult to measure the volume of pizza dough. Even though pizza dough or some gypsum. So if you go to dentist, they put some gypsum on your cavity and then they take it out and they make a mold. I don't know, it's a brace, right? It brace for your teeth, right? And I was thinking of that, still it's not clear. Okay. Good. If you have any question, then let's see. D destructive method is this one, and non-destructive method is here. People use some nuclear densometer to measure the density. This is very efficient because you can measure, you can repeat the measurement within minutes. So repetitive measurement is possible. So you put that equipment there and then just push the button and it's gonna give you the value, right? The dry density is blah, 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 1.7 or 1.62, right? It's rapid and useful to make a correct action because water content or the dry density, if you do a destruction test, destructive test, it takes about like 1 hour, right? And you have to wait because you need to oven dry for like 6 hours or 12 hours, right? So it takes about 12 hours in total. And meanwhile, they cannot wait. The field engineer should do their work because it's the money. So then, our measurement is like below like 30 centimeter and there was wrong. Not something wrong was the deadlift. You cannot, it's already gone. The people say that it's already gone. It's already like, now we have another lift here and you're talking about the one below. So it's a destruct method is difficult to apply because it has some time lag. But nuclear densometer, it gives you the result very soon, so it's easier to make a correct action. Okay? Corrective action, they can make a correct. But it's a high cost, and another very dangerous thing is that it has some nuclear material inside, isotope, radioactive isotope inside, so it can expose to the field personnel or the radiation. And to use the nuclear densometer, you have to have a certificate. 자격증이 있어야 돼. You have to have some certificate to use it. Okay? So it's hard to get the engineer. Principles, easy. You have a gamma radiation scattered by the soil, and denser soil have a more scatter, lighter soil, you have a less scatter. So from the scattering emission, the intensity, emission intensity, you can convert to the density. Water content is hydrogen atom, neutron scattered by the hydrogen atom.